Apparently this is a long session, so we're going to make a start because we're already late. Up first, we've got in this session Greg Hankins from Alcatel-Lucent. He's giving us an update on OpenIX and where they're going through trying to drive standardization in the interconnect industry. So if you can welcome Greg up, that'd be great. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Greg Hankins. I wear many hats or many different shirts sometimes. So today I'm speaking to you with my OpenIX shirt. Who here in the room has heard of OpenIX? Okay, so more people than I expected. I think we've talked about OpenIX in Asia a couple years ago, so maybe time for an update. So I'll tell you a little bit about what we're trying to do, what the association is about. The OpenIX Association is an internet community-based effort to create internet peering and interconnection standards. And we want to do that to improve peering and interconnection. We have a couple common standards that we've developed for IXPs and data centers. So we certify and promote the organizations that apply for those standard certifications, so IXPs and data centers. And we use these community-developed standards in order to have a common ground when comparing services from an IXP or a data center. What's our value proposition? So like I said, we have these common criteria that we use to deliver a measurable certification that you can use to compare when you're looking for an IXP or a data center to go to. We have standards that focus on a couple different physical, technical, and operational requirements. So the idea is that if you're looking at an OpenIX certified entity, be it an IXP or a data center, and you're comparing locations in a country or even locations between two different countries, you know exactly what you're getting, and it's an apples to apples comparison because you're comparing a certified entity. From an organizational standpoint, the membership and the organization is completely transparent, and the certification process is also open. The certification is first examined by a committee, and then it goes out to the membership for comments. So it's not a closed certification like you might have some other standards organizations or other telecom organizations. The board of directors, I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this slide. The point is that the board of directors comes from the community. It's people that you already know and probably do business with or have maybe known for several years. It's not some outside group like the ITU that's trying to come in and regulate. This is really an effort that's driven from the community, and it's developed by the community, and it's developed for the community. So it's all people that are within the community, and most of them are network operators or data center operators themselves. We have a bunch of committees that do a lot of the work that I'll tell you about briefly. We have the IXP Standards Committee. This is the committee that's in charge of developing and maintaining the OIX1 IXP standards, so anything related to an IXP that's in the standard. We also have a data center committee. This committee, like the IXP committee, is developing the OpenIX2 standards for data centers. We also have a marketing committee. They're in charge of promoting the OpenIX organization, getting the word out, and also working with certified companies. And then we have the membership committee, which is in charge of the memberships. Certification-wise, any company can apply for a certification. There's no requirement for membership or anything like that. When you're certified, that means that your company complies with the standard, and we provide these marks for you to use on your public website or collateral or whatever you want to do. And this also provides an easy way for network operators to identify a certified entity. Now, this is an open standard, so of course you can choose to be compliant without becoming certified just by looking at what's in the standard and then doing all those things. That's totally up to you, of course. The standards, like I said, we have two standards. OIX1 is for IXP. It covers the IXP infrastructure, things like the ports, the frame types that are allowed, so basic security practices, things like that, operational practices. On the data center side, it covers more of the infrastructure things, so things like the utility, the transformer power, water feeds, things like that. And the key point of both of these standards is that they require that all this information is open and accessible on the respective company's public website. So, like the certification process, the certified member also has a very transparent process with all the documentation and services that they provide. It's all open and transparent on the website. We have a big focus on international certifications. OpenIX started out as a North American organization, but since then we've expanded the certifications internationally as we see the same demand for neutral and open services in other countries. We currently have 4 international entities, 3 exchanges, and 1 data center. I'll just go through these quickly. We have 10 IXPs, AMZIX across the US, also in Amsterdam and Hong Kong, DE-CIX in New York, Flix in Miami, Lynx in Northern Virginia, and then also MassIX in Boston and MIX in Milan are OIX1 certified. The OIX2 data centers, we have about 30 data centers. This slide is a little dense, so I don't want to read it to you, but you kind of get the point in the value of certification. So I live in Atlanta sometimes when I'm home and not traveling the world. So if, for example, I was looking for a data center in Atlanta, I could look at QTS, who's in Atlanta, and Zayo, who's in Atlanta. And I know that both of these organizations are OIX certified, so I know that when I go to these vendors for a proposal for data center space, I know I'm getting the same thing because they're both certified, and I can compare apples to apples what they're trying to offer. Here's a global view of the certification, and you notice there's a lot of North American organizations, not much in Asia, and not much in the rest of the world. So like I said, that's a big focus for us, is how to get this standard more international so that you have a better global view of certified entities. For membership, this is a personal membership. Anyone that's interested can become a member. There's no requirements of any organization affiliation or job title or anything like that. The member benefits, right now, it may not look like a lot. We're trying to redefine the value of the membership. Right now, you're able to vote and participate in elections, and you're also able to comment on the certification applications. The membership is, there's only one membership, it's $50 a year. And if you're interested in being a member, you can apply on the website. Initiatives for 2016, this is a slide where I wanted to spend most of the time. So as I said, OpenIX is now a couple years old. We're moving from sort of the startup phase of an organization into a more mature phase where we're trying to plan for the long time. So some of the things that we did, or that the organization did a couple years ago, were reevaluating those things and figuring out how to grow the organization to be a more sustainable and long-term organization. So some of those things, for example, are growing a reserve for a longer term, redefining the budget, and looking at how we do operations and things like that. So we've divided the objectives into a couple tactical short-term things that we're going to change, and then also several strategic long-term things that we're working on. So in the short term, we've just redone all the committees. So we appointed new members to committees. The committees are electing new chairs, so we're trying to bring some new energy into committees that had maybe gotten a little bit stale. And we're also trying to look at all of our operations and how we do things. For me personally, you saw from the board list, we're all technologists and network engineers, but we do some silly things. Our membership right now is an Excel spreadsheet, so that's kind of that's not the greatest way to do it with all this CMS technology and membership management systems. So we're looking at trying to figure out how to grow the organization from a spreadsheet-based organization to something that really scales with more members and more certifications. A number of you have been wondering about the AIS, the America's Interconnection Summit. This was an event that we first held last year in April. We're planning one for this year again. We haven't announced the dates yet because it's not ready quite yet. But there's clearly interest in this event. 2 people have already tried to register this month for last year's event. So we know at least 2 people are coming or would like to come. For AIS, and the idea also is to combine the AGM, our annual general meeting, with AIS this year so that there's only one event, because obviously our event calendars are really full already. In the long term, the strategic things that we want to do, as I mentioned, is expand certifications around the world. The value of certification really grows as we have more certified entities. So the more people that are certified and the more people that are applying for this common standard, the better it is for the network operator community, because it means more choice for you. So that's one of our big initiatives. The other one is admittedly, and everyone on the board will admit this, that I think we've kind of lost what the value proposition is, in particular, to become a personal member. And for the certified members, I think there's a lot that we need to do in order to increase the value proposition and try and get new members and new certified entities. So that's not entirely clear. One of the ways that we want to do that is by developing a couple new standards. So both for OIX1, the IXP certification, and for OIX2, the data center certification, we're looking at having different tiers for IXPs or data centers that are maybe a little bit smaller or maybe don't meet all the requirements for a full certification. We're looking at tiers of certification. And then the other thing that is really a big focus for us too is on education. So we want to develop some collateral, also some model RFPs, sample questions that you can ask that basically simplify your purchases when you're looking to go to an IXP or a data center. So things that you could just copy and paste into an RFP that would help you get that out quicker to your vendors. Here's how you can contact us. I listed a bunch of addresses, and obviously our webpage has all this information too. And that's really all I wanted to say, is I wanted to see if anyone had any questions or comments, any criticisms. I'm yelled at quite a lot after presentations, so hey, Tom.
Hi, Tom Paseka from Cloudflare. Can you give a rough estimate as to when AIS will be held and where?
We're looking at sometime in the fall. It's difficult because the calendar is already full, and I don't know if you saw Greg Dendy's presentation at EPF, but he basically projected that in a couple years we'd have more conferences than we can actually physically attend. So I think we're almost to that point right now. But obviously with the different technical conferences like NANOG, RIPE, and then EPF and GPF, we're trying to figure out a place in between all those conferences where AIS makes sense. But I can't say anything yet because then everyone will use that date and we may end up changing it.
So this year we have the leap day, so.
Yeah.
just one clarification question. What is a remote peering IXP?
That is a good question, and it's vague on here, so we're looking at anything that's not currently the OIX1 certification specifies that an ISP is in a metropolitan area. So it would be any ISP that is not in a metropolitan area.
So it might be distributed IXPs?
Yeah, distributed ISPs or whatever ISPs that span a bigger area than a metro area. So that would be, all these things are still to be determined, so that's why I'm answering in a vague way, but yes.
Excellent. Please thank Greg.
Right. If you're interested, come and talk to me. Also, if you have private criticism or comment, I'm glad to hear those too.
Thanks, Greg. Next up, we have Toyama-san. Who's going to give us an update on what APIX is up to and its members.
Hello. Well, my name is Katsuyasu Toyama, and I am a chair of the APIX Association. And a little update about the APIX. So the next slide here. As you know, the APIX is an association of Internet Exchange Point in the Asia-Pacific region. So just like in the Euro-IX or LACIX or AFIX in other regions, the IXP people get together and share some kind of information or knowledge about it. Okay, so currently APIX member is 19. And the new members are Mega-IX from Australia and also IX Australia from Australia. Yeah. So currently, the 19 members, and we are from 13 countries and economies. So Bangladesh, Hong Kong, Japan, Korea, or Indonesia, or India, or Malaysia, and Nepal, New Zealand, Singapore, Thailand, Vietnam, and Australia. That's the 13 countries and economies. Okay. And we received the application for membership from CHNIX, which is located in Beijing, China, and also the MZIX Hong Kong. And we are now investigating that, okay? And the current steering committee, including me, the 5 seats, and me and Shehu from the HKIX, and AJ from NIXI, and Brian from Kings, and Gavin from the MegaIX. This time we had an election, and Gaurab stepped down, and Gavin are new steering committee members. So these pipes are steer the APIX, okay? And this time we had a 13th meeting. Usually we collocate with an APIX or APRICOT meeting. So, and this time the attendees from the 14 IXPs have over the APX members and remotely attended one IXP. And the potential member this time in China, CHNIX and AMS IX Hong Kong and the PH Open IX from Philippines, they are also joined. And these meetings are already always supported by APNIC, so thank you very much for APNIC. And this time, so IXP from the other regions, so M6, DE-CIX, E6, NetNot, AFIS, joined and also invited and the vendor of the entity or advanced technologies. And we discussed the new member and from the of the presentation from the new members and the potential members, and also we did an update. And we did an also election, okay? And in a technical session, we asked to make a speech from our Netflix, and also the UIX and the peering DB from the Arnold, and also another route server platform, the GoBGP, as presented by JPNAP, and also optical switches from the NTT Advanced Technologies, and Philippines market situation from the Archie of the PH OpenNet. And we did an election, okay? And I'd like to show you that some kind of the key performance indicators for IXPs in the APEC region. Prepared the three type of the KPI, the number of ASN and the peak traffic, and average traffic per ASN. That means that the peak traffic is divided by the number of ASN of each IXP, yeah. The third one is seems to indicate that the countries the broadband traffic is in the, bigger or not. I mean that each ISPs or each ASN has a big traffic, then in the countries, a lot of the broadband users are there. Yeah. Okay. So this information is collected from these IXPs in the Asian area. Okay, so this data is sent by yesterday, for the IXP updates that will make a presentation later. And please take a look at this. So the number of connected ASN is approximately at this range. I mean that over 200 is the top one of the HKIX, and others are approximately 100 or the 50 or this range. So we are comparing to the Europe, the big IXPs had a lot much more connected ASNs. Yeah, but then in Asia, we have this range. Is that the number of ASN? And also the peak traffic is described here. So the top one and also the HKIX, approximately 600 gig. And the JPNAP is also that over the 500, and the JPIX is also. And these are the big IXPs in the Asian Pacific region. And unfortunately, we could not get the data from the Equinix, so the Equinix EIE, that's not shown here. So, okay, so these are the performance of the agent IXPs. Okay, and average traffic per ASN is described here. So the top one is Hankins. So the per ASN, they have more over than 6 gigabit per second. And also the next one is JPNAP and approximately 4 or 5. So this means, and I think that Korea and Japan having a lot of broadband subscribers. It's a result, as shown in this graph, I think. Okay, well, thank you very much for our APIX. And do you have any comments or questions?
Hi, this is Rafael from Equinix. Unfortunately, we don't disclose individual stats for each exchange, but off the record, no one heard this, we peaked at 650 in our Singapore exchange, so.
Oh, 650? That is an
650.
650, accumulated. The summary one?
Singapore.
One simple? Singapore. Okay. Okay, later. Please give us that information. Okay.
Hi, Katsuyasu-san. I heard from you that you decide APIX decided to collect an annual fee.
Oh, annual fee. Yeah.
Yeah, please.
Oh. Okay. So this time we decided to collect the membership fee, $100 per year. Yeah, very not expensive, but it's very hard for us because some organizations feel some difficulty to authorize such kind of payment of the membership fee. But we have we decided to move forward because we may need more money in the future. So we decided this time to collect a membership fee. And in the future, we may or may not increase, compensate for the cost.
Okay, and also to let you know, we already decided to apply for APIX.
Oh, of course, yes, please.
You will see the application very soon.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much. Okay, so that's one, slide. Now, the Global Peering Forum, as you may know, will be held on April the 11th to 14th at Hollywood in California. So we would like to encourage the ISPs to join, to participate in the Global Peering Forum, especially encourage the Asian ISPs to join there. And currently, approximately 200 people are already registered from mainly from US or Europe and South America. So we would like to encourage the Asian people to get together and talk about the peering. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Toyama-san. Up next, I think we have Arnold Nipper from DE-CIX, but I think he is wearing a EuroIX hat to give us an update.
Yeah, this time I wear my other hat. Fortunately, in the morning, Aaron was so kind to took my third hat off. So what I do is I give you a short update or introduction what EuroIX is. So Katsuyasu already mentioned EuroIX. EuroIX is the same what APIX is for the Asia-Pacific region. It's EuroIX for the European region. So we are also an association of IXPs. We are meanwhile around since more than 15 years, I guess. We were founded in 2001, as far as I remember. So far, we are 53 IXPs from the EuroIX regions. We more or less follow with the regions as the RIRs do. And we also take memberships from other IXPs from the rest of the world. For example, our newest members, MegaIX from Australia, and we also have new members from Europe as well, OM NIX from Bulgaria, Dataline IX. So besides IXPs as member, we also have patrons, so-called patrons, which are not directly members, but guarantee that we have a budget to do our work. We currently have 13 members or 13 patrons, mostly, or we started with the typical patrons, which were our switchgear vendors like Alcatel-Lucent, now Nokia, Brocade, Extreme Networks, Huawei, Juniper, but later on also optical gear vendors like Anatver, MRV, joined, and we also then finally added co-location operators like Telecity, Telehouse as patrons, and the latest patrons is ESI Telecom, which is also sort of switch vendor, optical gear vendor, and Flex Optics, which more are in the transceiver business, coding of transceivers. So basically, what do we do? So the main benefits of our members is attending two forums per year. We have a spring forum, which is always around late of April. Next time is, if you're interested or IXP is interested to join, is 23rd and until 25th of April in a small city in Europe, Luxembourg. You may perhaps have your money over there. The other one is in autumn, around October-ish. And these are meetings where we meanwhile have up to 120 to 130 people from up to 50, 60 IXPs, where we do not only discuss technical things, but also marketing things, political things, because we have the European Union, we do these things of things. Then next is, besides the fora, is we have a website with database behind it. I come later on, I guess I come still, to the database and tools. We have a monthly newsletter, which might be of interest to you if you want to subscribe, follow these rules. And also what we do is an annual European IXP report, which is be found very useful by a lot of people. They are interested in doing so. We are compiling information about IXPs, where are the IXPs, not only from the European region, but from all over the world. Then we do internal things, benchmarking, and we do it for the good of the community and good of the internet. So as said, there, besides Eurex and APIX, we have a body which is called Internet Exchange Federation. This is the Federation of Internet Exchange Point Association. Currently, we have these IXPAs, we have Eurex, APIX for the Asia Pacific region, AFIX, LAC, LACIX, and what currently forms is NIIX. NIIX is still in its infancy. I would say it's more or less a group or discussion list. They meet typically at NANOC meetings and come together. So URIX, APIX, AFIX, and LAXIX, they came to an agreement to work together, and they've actually found IXIF. We have this memorandum of understanding, originally signed by these three IX, APIX, URX, and LACIX, and AFIX recently joined. The basic idea behind is to have a global database where all the IXP information goes into. So We have heard from the presentation from Hurricane Electric that we still have a couple of databases around where IXP information is stored. This most mainly is PeeringDB. We have the PCH database, which is around since more than 20 years, I guess. And we also have the URXDB. And our main target is really to consolidate and to make it as coherent as possible. And also, on top of this, to develop tools for automatic data collection. So you may imagine, so I guess if you count all of the IXPs around the world, this sums up to 350 or something like that. And to keep all the information up to date, you have to have automated tools for this. So as I said, this is the IXF board. These are the persons. Some of them, or most of them, are also over here. You might find this very interesting. There's a movie which explains what an IXP is. It is really a nice movie. I only can recommend it, and this is available in a lot of languages: English, French, Turkish, Spanish, Romanian, Portuguese, Arabic, and German. And I have a commitment also from CHN IX to translate it to, it's Mandarin? Mandarin, thank you. And so this is really very, very useful, and not only, I guess, for IXPs, but also for ISPs to show it to your customers and have really to explain them how the internet works. So this is more or less already what I covered. I already talked about it. There's no single source about it. It's poor quality. We try to improve it, and so on and so on. I guess I skipped this. What we are working on is really on clients, so that you are able to automate things. So this is currently how it works. We are already working closely together with PeeringDB, more or less. It will not matter where an IXP puts the information in, being it PeeringDB or the IXFDB, you still will always have the same API for it. Again, how it works in detail. What we also come up is to have tools for automation. You need a scheme how an IXP is defined. And so we finally came up with an JSON schema to represent it. And this is an example how we do it. So we have currently APIs. And if you pull the information from it, you, for example, get all these information, the IXP info, and then you have a list of members. You can see it. Then you are able to compare it with whom you're already peering with. This is my peers, 8916, 2940, and so on. And then you do a for loop and say, okay, just pull out the information from IXF or from PeeringDB, and this gives you then a nice script or list with whom you still do not peer with and perhaps should peer with. So the idea behind this is what we have seen in the last year or last 2 years. Everything has to be automated, and this gives you the single API for many IXPs. You do not have to pull information from the IXP site, but still can go to one database, have one script, and then you are done. This is where I encourage each IXP who is in the room to follow this JSON scheme. It's fairly easy, and I guess it does not take longer for an experienced programmer to convert your internal tools to fill in the JSON scheme than, let's say, more a day or a 1.5. Okay, this is where we store the information to increase use of automation, that's it says. Then, last slide, Katsuyasu was already talking about this, and I have the final two slides. This is the IXPs in the APIX region. I do not know whether the figures are correct. It's roughly 90 to 100 IXPs in 50 cities, 20 countries. And check out the map. We try to keep it as accurate as possible. This was what we also do is we try to collect the traffic data. We try to automate it. Unfortunately, it's stopped end of last year or September last year because we did a redesign of our website, and we do not have the figures for the latest figures until this year. But what you can see is, I do not know why the traffic went down in April, but what typically see is it does not go up all the time. You have something like when students go onto a holiday that traffic goes down. But if you extrapolate, you see that you have an exponential growth of all the times. That's it from my side on URIX.
Any questions?
Any specific questions what URIX does different from what APIX does? What could we do better for the networks? Any suggestions?
You must have covered everything.
Nothing. Everyone is tired, I guess.
Okay. Excellent.
Thank you.
Thanks, Arnold. It's time for Tomio-san to come back up again, and he's going to be driving the IXP updates. So you can tell us who you went up first.
Hi, Toyama again. And I will talk about an IXP update. So usually IXP people get here and talk in 1 minute, but then it also take a long time. So due to the time limitation, I will talk about each IXP's information. So during the my talk, please stand up the IXP people when I talk your IXP information, okay? So this is the today's list. Okay, I forgot to count, but too many. So this is an alphabetical order, and the left-hand side is the first in the Asia-Pacific region, and the right-hand side is in the other regions. So I will talk an update on these ones. So the first one is in the AMSIX. Okay, so AMSIX is Hong Kong. Oh, they have the four presence in Hong Kong, and 28 SN connected, and the 21 gigabyte. And they are doing the IPX for the mobile operators. So Mark or Hank, yeah, over there. So if you would like to talk with them, this IXP, please talk them. Okay, so going to the next. And the BBIX, okay. So BBIX has six internet exchanges. So Singapore and Hong Kong and Tokyo. And Osaka and Nagoya and Fukuoka. So unfortunately, they do not disclose the ASN and the peak traffic. But if you would like to talk with the BBIX, then where is the BBX people? No? So please looking for them using this picture, okay? Remember, okay. And unfortunately, currently I uploaded this slide on the APNIC site, but the link is slightly old. So now you cannot access, but later, please access to the file and download, and please see this information, okay? Next, our BKNIX. BKNIX is in our IX in Bangkok and Thailand. They have one point of presence here, and currently 13th and 7.2 gig. And they will, their update is in, they will have a member meeting number 2, and prepare for the second site, and arranging the BKX peering forum. This is the information. So they encourage to join the peering forum. Okay, so Nam, where are you? Oh yeah, over there. Yes, Nam, yes. He is in the contact point of the BKX, okay? Okay, go on to the next. Next is the CHN IX. Oh, this is very new for us, but in the Beijing, the Yali is trying to build the internet exchange. Okay, so data center is described here. The current layer connected is in a 2, but now they will increase soon. Okay, so also they are planning to have an internet exchange in Shanghai and sorry, I cannot read that. Yeah. So another point, they are trying to have an IX in the second quarter of this year. So okay, Yali, okay. And next, next to DE-CIX, which are also called the PIX. This is an old internet exchange in Japan, Tokyo, and this is operated from the academic. And Pixie is a new one, which is using SDN technology. Okay, so Sekiya-san is here? Not? Okay, so that's unfortunate. He's a very big guy, very fat guy, okay? And next is HKIS, is in Hong Kong, and the two point of presence, and they will they are planning to have more site. And the recent updates is they installed the L-Layer 2 ACL access list, and also they are planning to have an DDoS protection and proxy ARP protection in this year. Okay, so the Shehu? He's the famous person of the HKIX. Oh, you can recognize because he's very tall. Okay, and next, IX Australia. IX Australia has a lot of internet exchange in the Australia. So the NSWIX in Sydney and Melbourne and Perth and Brisbane and Adelaide and Canberra. Okay. And Adelaide and Canberra, the free four members. Oh, great. Good contribution. Okay. And recent update is in here. The IX Australia is operated by Internet Association of Australia, which was formerly known as the West Australian Internet Association. Okay, so Joe. Oh, there. So he's in IX Australia. Okay. And also Auckland Internet Exchange, which is also currently operated by IX Australia. But soon they are move their operation into the New Zealand society, okay? But then currently the contact point is also the Joe, okay? Joe, okay. And the next one is JPIX. JPIX has two internet exchange in Tokyo and Osaka, and both internet exchange also have a contact point in Nagoya. Okay, so recent update is increasing the number of the 100 gig port users, and the traffic is significantly increasing these days. Okay, so the contact point is in Yoshiki-san. Please stand up. Oh yeah, the Mawatari-san and Yoshiki-san. Okay. Okay, so the next is the JPNAP. JPNAP has three internet exchange, two in Tokyo and one in Osaka. And the recent update is in GoBGP. GoBGP is an alternate route server platform and now being tested, so not in production, but we hope to be a good resolver. And also, JSON-based web API is released, and 100 gig users also increased steadily. Yeah, 10% of the user is in the 100 gig. So the contact person is in a lot of guys, so please sign up, okay? Oh, this one, okay? And including me, okay. And the next is the Kinks. Kinks has one internet exchange, mainly in Seoul, but their POP is also in Hong Kong and LA. Yeah, so in Seoul, they have the 3 POP, and in Hong Kong, Mega I, in LA, the 1 wheelchair. Yeah, they have an access point. And the recent update is a new route server was taking place last year. They're using the bird also. And new POP will be on the consideration at 2016. I think, unfortunately, the King's people is not here. Not here, okay. And the next one is Mega IX. Mega IX also has exchange point in various area. So Sydney, Melbourne, and Brisbane, and Singapore, Hong Kong, and Auckland. And the Gavin, also the APX steering committee member, is in the contact person. Yep. And the Mega also has an IX, not in the Asian region, but that will be touched later. And next one is a Malaysian Internet Exchange, MYIX. They have the Kuala Lumpur and Cyberjaya. They have the access point. Okay, currently there is number 71, oh great. And the peak traffic is over the 100 gig. Okay, so Mohan. Why it's not here? Oh, that's unfortunate. Okay. The next one is in the NPIX, the Nepal IX. And they have the two rings in the Kathmandu. Oh, not the ring, the two internet exchanges in the Kathmandu. Okay, one is the Extreme and one is Juniper. And the recent updates is that they looking forward to Google and Akamai and other CDNs to come and appear directly. Oh, that is a plan? Yeah. I don't know, no. So, no Gaurav, and okay, also Samit, no? Oh yeah, over there, so sorry about that. Okay, so here's a person of the NetBIX, okay? The next is in the VH OpenIX from Philippines. Oh, they have the two IXs in Manila and Cebu, but that will be increased and soon. Because the PH OpenIX and the cable is landing to Cebu in the future, so the Cebu will be the very good city for internet exchange. And the Manila also, they have the 45 SNs and the 13 gigabits. So, yeah. Okay, here. Get back. Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Not his picture. Yeah. And SGIX, the Singapore Internet Exchange, they have the Singapore and two POPs in Global Switch and the OneNet, and 62 ASN. And their recent update is an upgrading of the peering infrastructure in third quarter to handle more connections. Oh, it's very interesting. Okay, so Chunsen is here. Jeff? No? Oh, yeah, that's unfortunate, okay. And the next one is the SOX, and also the Singapore Internet Exchange, Singapore Open Internet, Open Exchange. And they also have the two POPs and the 27 ASN. They're established in September 2001, so slightly 01. Okay, so unfortunately, the SOX people are not here, I think. And the last one in Asian Pacific region, the Taipei, in the Taipei, the TPIX. So the William is then the person, okay? So they have two POP and 20 ASNs. And the recent updates are the new members, the Hurricane, Cloudflare, Akamai, and HOIA, and the DCTV, and the Bobnet. Yeah, so he made a presentation today, so he becomes very popular this is. Okay. Okay, so these are the list of the Asian Pacific region. And in the other regions, from other regions, AMSIX, they have the AMSIX in Amsterdam and Curacao and Chicago and Bay Area and New York. Okay, so the recent update is in the new Falcon route servers. Oh, interesting. And AMSIX portal software as a service, they started to sell or licensing the software, okay? And they started the Megaport partnership with the Megaport, okay? So the contact person is the Mark or Hank. Yeah, they are the contact person of the AMSIX, okay? And next one is DE-CIX. So DE-CIX has an IXS in Frankfurt and New York and Istanbul and will be in Madrid. So that is in that very interesting update in the Madrid. Okay. Yep. So the Arnold is a contact person. Okay. Yeah. He also made a lot of presentation now. And this is from Africa, South Africa. So Jinx, Sings, and Dings, Johannesburg, and Cape Town, and Durban. They already have substantial traffic there. Okay, so the recent update is the multi-site from the March 1st, coming near. Yeah, great. So, okay. Yeah. Oh, over there. Sorry about that. Okay. And the Mega IX again. They have also the North in the IX in North America. Dallas and Los Angeles and New York. And the North Virginia. Silicon Valley, Dallas, Los Angeles, New York, Chicago, and North Virginia and Seattle. Oh, a lot of places. Yeah. Okay. So the Gavin is a contact person. Okay. And NetNot, they're from Sweden. So they have the two, one from the Stockholm and the other is the Copenhagen, Denmark. Okay, so currently they have a lot of ISPs in their exchanges and traffic is heavily exchanged. Okay. Yeah. So, okay. Okay, over there, yeah. Yeah, they are the contact point of the NetNot. Okay, thank you. Thank you for IXP update. Just a little longer, but happy peering at IXP. That is, I think, very important thing. Thank you very much. And if you have questions, please ask each contact person. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is Rajesh from Nixie in the room? Rajesh has got a quick IXP update for Nixie. If you just want to jump on the microphone in the middle. Just do it there, yeah.
Rajesh Charya, Director, National Internet Exchange of India. In the morning session when I've just updated about the Nixie's draft proposal, it has not been finalized. The Nixie's board meeting is in the month of March, but this is the draft paper which is in circulation within the board. And I hope that this will be agreed unanimously by the Nixie board about our future plan. When the Nixie was started, just I will give you a small brief why this change has taken place. When the Nixie was started, in the Nixie, the only the ISP who are having their internet service license can connect. And there was one formula for connecting all the big players because there the peering is the open peering in between the ISPs so that the Nixie should not compete with their members. We have created an atmosphere of X minus Y, which was unique all over the Malay in the world about the Nixie. And we have started with the $1 per GB and now we have come down to the 1 rupee per GB. Content is a very important for the internet users, for the better user experience. And looking towards the broadband target of 600 million broadband by 2020, we decided among the Nixie that why we are not allowing the content to connect to the Nixie. We hope that from by the end of March or in this year, 2016, we are allowing the content to connect to the NICSI, but with this very small correction that we are not allowing the content directly connect to the NICSI node. We are creating a parallel rack beside the NICSI node so that any ISP who are interested in connecting to the NICSI, they can connect to content also in the bilateral pairing. We are not forcing the multilateral pairing with the content. We are allowing the bilateral pairing with the content, and any content player wants to connect to any ISP within the NICSI, it will be connected. One thing is there is no X minus Y will be applicable on the content player. Only the port charges have to be paid, and the port charges will be also very nominal, which anybody can bear about that. The X minus Y charges is only applicable for the ISPs, because in our country, the regulation of the service tax is there, and whatsoever we are transferring with each other, we have to bill something. If we will not bill 1 rupee per GB, the government of India will value this item in any number to just to safeguard our members, we are creating 1 rupee there. So this is the new draft resolution which is going on into the NICSI board, and we hope that by next month it will be finalized, and then it will be updated very soon to all the community members. Presently, the traffic in the NICSI, the peak traffic is 48 GB consolidated of all the exchange point within the country. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Rajesh. I look forward to hearing.
Martin Levy from Cloudflare, again at the microphone. Rajesh, if I may ask a question. You have within this room and many other rooms like this a lot of experts in the internet exchange business. Is it possible that NICSI can become more like other exchanges? The X minus Y, you've just, in fact, actually in one sentence declared why it needs to exist. And arguing against the Indian government is a foolish thing that no one in this room would do openly. But 1 rupee is still 1 rupee. It's still an X minus Y calculation. Is there any way for you to take that down to a tenth of a rupee, a hundredth of a rupee, something that is minimal? Because the network, the internet has grown, and you know this, and you have a country with 600 million projected, it's going to grow again. That number by scale has to change. That's one question. And the second question is, an ISP versus a content play, is this between the licensing, the different style of licensing for ISPs versus content that doesn't have license? How does one separate an AS number into one bucket versus the other bucket? That's the clarification I'd like as a second question.
Regarding the first question of the 1 rupee, we have come down from 50 rupees to 1 rupee, number one. We were interested that we should remove this X minus Y all along. But just to cover up that X minus Y, we have to create then port charges, and we have to increase the port charges, which we don't want to do, because into our exchange, the smaller ISPs are there and the larger ISPs are there. And the biggest problem within the country is the last mile. National long distance is costly. So what we are planning is that we should be able to reduce this 1 rupees to 15 ya paisa even, half a rupee, very shortly. But at least from 1st of January, we are planning to shift it to the 1 rupee. And we have to keep some value, minimal value, so that the service tax department should not impose any tax on their thought's value rather than our thought value, number one. Number two, regarding the competition, there is no competition. There is no licensing. Only the content player who will be residing into the NICSI rack will be doing the due diligence, like the registration sort of thing. Nothing with the DOT, and nothing will be there, because the traffic will move through the content players' traffic will move through the ISP. The ISPs are already regulated, so there is no double regulation on that. We want to simplify as much as possible, and even down the government, Prime Minister office is getting involved for simplifying the rules of the ISP and IT sector so much, so that anybody should feel and be able to give their contribution for achieving 600 million broadband target.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The second part, and I know there's no time. the second part, thank you. That actually is a very clear understanding. On the first part, a reduction of 50 to 1, which is, I know, based on today's exchange rate, unfortunately, is the internet's gone much bigger than that in that time period. So my closing remark is, please try to remove that number and you know, seriously reduce it. There are other things I'd like to talk about. I have no time at the microphone.
But Martin, 1 rupee is very negligible looking towards the present system. But if we will not keep any, you can say, justify value, unnecessarily Department of Finance will put on us a lot of value. So just to safeguard that, we have decided that when the big players are peering with each other in 2 rupee or 3 rupee, why not keep this 1 rupee or 15 naya paisa? I can assure that very soon you will be heard that 15 naya paisa, then quarter of the rupee, this will happen.
A much longer conversation. I welcome you to the microphone at the next meeting for a more extensive conversation.
Definitely.
Hi, Rajesh. I know you guys have been working on this for a long time. Yes. Donald Clark from Google. It's great to hopefully see something emerge. Look forward to reading it and all the rest of it. A question I have is, are these additional switches, this additional infrastructure that you're setting up in parallel to the core domestic licensed infrastructure, is it going to be at the places that people like Google is at, right? Or is it going to be in the same locations where NIXIE is, where the content players really aren't today? Because that's going to affect how successful it is for you.
We are trying this, I will say the trial, of this connecting a parallel rack beside to the NIXIE rack. We are starting from the Noida. The NetMagic NTT Docomo data center is over there. It is under the discussion, so I will not be able to say what will be emerging very soon, but what rack we are creating is just, I will say, the switch wherein you can bring your network to that location, and from that switch, if you want to give to any ISP, PNI peering, you are most welcome.
So I guess my point, already established locations, and generally to be successful, you know, you might want to go where they are more than expect them to now invest additionally to come to you. But that's something that will play out over time.
That will be going in a long way. Let's see. You want?
Yes.
So I should be beside you?
Sure. Okay. Owen DeLong, Akamai. Do I understand correctly that you're building this parallel switch infrastructure and then only allowing PNIs, not allowing peering across the exchange fabric from the content providers?
I referred because the Google was there, and I was using the PNI, otherwise there is no about that. And it will be a peering, direct peering, with, from the ISP to content peer. Thank you, I think.
Thank you, Rajesh. I think Rajesh will be standing outside for questions afterwards.
Thank you.
Next up, we've got Vijay from Equinix, Renumbering in Sydney and Singapore.
Hi, this is Vijay here from Equinix. Well, before going into the IP address renumbering that we are going to do on Singapore and Sydney IX platform, I would like to just go about give some looking back updates on the IX platform. Basically, we first launched the IX platform in APAC in the year 2005 with a couple of /25 subnets. And then we have actually seen consistent customer base and port growth. So we had to actually expand our /25 to /24 in 2011. And at around end of 2008, we actually introduced IPv6 peering also. Recently, over the recent years, we have actually seen rapid traffic growth, and we are currently at 1.1 terabit IPv4 aggregated at peak, and 30 gig traffic on IPv6. So in order to actually serve customer demand and more ports to be added, we have actually done a lot of upgrades along the way, like switch fabric upgrades to add high density modules, and we also added new switches and also did software upgrades for adding the 100 gig modules for the customers. Over the period, we have also used a lot of three different flavors of route servers in our platform. We first started off with Quagga, and then we actually moved on to OpenBGPD, and now we have actually settled in Bird. We are also actually planning to evaluate the GoBGP routing daemon. Hopefully, by next year, we should be able to have some update on that. So currently, as on December 15, 95% IP address of the existing /24 in Singapore and Sydney IX platforms are already assigned to the customers. So that actually warrants to do the IP address renumbering in those two metros. So as part of planning for the IP address renumbering, we actually started the planning at around end of November 2015. And we actually thought of, we first thought whether we want to go for /23 or go to /22. So we thought, okay, let's go to /22 and I don't need to do any more IP address renumbering with Equinix. Okay. Then we also evaluated whether to actually go for a big bang renumbering or parallel run, but based on our past experiences and learning from different IXPs, we decided that okay, let's go with parallel run. So as part of planning, we also needed to actually collect the peering details, customer details, verify the contacts, because in most of the peering DB updates, we don't find the correct records. So for some of the customers, we had to actually contact them and make sure that the contact we are working with is correct. And then we also collected the total number of prefixes in the old route server so that we can actually match it with the new route server. Okay, as part of backend work, while our AP NOC is being actually announcing the emails to the customers, we worked at the backend to install new route servers, new pair of route servers with Bird daemon, and then we actually did rigorous testing on it, integrating it with the NMS tools so that the NMS tool can actually generate the configurations and also do the monitoring tests. Apart from that, we have also did new feature testings on the new route server, like RTBH for the IXP platform. Like, we have actually heard from our customers that they are actually looking for RTBH feature in the IXP platform. So we have actually we have done the testing, and we are hope to actually release it soon, because we have to actually work with our NMS team to automate the configuration push and so on. So that is pending for update for now. And as part of getting the new server ready, we actually invited couple of peering participants to peer with a new route server as a pilot customers. Okay, this is actually a general plan that we actually followed for both Singapore and Sydney metros. And this is how, our NOC actually followed this schedule. So we actually started 9 weeks ahead of the parallel run period. So the first announcement to all our peering participants went out 9 weeks ahead of the parallel run. And every 15 to 20 days, we actually send reminder emails to all the peering participants. And we have actually asked the participants to acknowledge that they have received the email and they are ready to actually do the IP address renumbering. So for those we have received the acknowledgments, we have actually replied them with the new IP address. And basically the new IP address, first three octets will only change. The fourth octet will remain same. So 1 week before the parallel run, we actually sent final reminder. And basically the Singapore parallel run has just finished from 15 to 19 February. However, there are like around 25 customers still haven't bring up their new peering with our new route servers. So our NOC is parallelly following with them before we actually shut down our server on 1st of March after we actually migrate the IPv6 from the old server to the new route server. So basically there's no change in the IPv6 number. We will actually just move the IPv6 IP from the old route server to the new route server, and then we will shut it down. For Sydney, the plan is to start the parallel run starting from 15 to 20th March. So we hope that all the customers, all the peering participants can bring up their new peer during that time period. Okay, this is just a picture representation on how we are going to do the migration. though we have already completed Singapore, the Sydney is going to happen 15 March to 20th March. And after 21st March, we will try to actually shut down the old peers one by one. So by the time we are ready to migrate our IPv6 by end of the month, end of March, there won't be any old peers exist. Okay, when I was actually talking to the guys here during the breaks, I actually understand that people are actually having misconception that it may be a outage-prone migration, but it is not. Basically, you just need to configure secondary IP address on your interface and then bring up all the new BGP peers, and then you can just remove the old primary IP address from your interface. So this is just a sample config template that you can refer to, but you don't need to use it as is. And for every other vendor, it operates differently. Like for Cisco, there is a secondary tag to be added with the secondary IP address. For Brocade, you don't need to add anything. You can add as many IP addresses of different subnets within the interface. And for Juniper, it is pretty easy also. Okay, this is the latest update as on 20th of February. We have actually seen 80% of the customers peered with the new route server. Basically, we anticipated that there will be few customers that will not bring up the new peer because the Chinese New Year just ended, and we actually scheduled our parallel migration just after CNY. So we actually anticipated that there will be some customers may not have bring up the BGP. So that's why you can see 80% of the customers have not bring up, 80% of customers have peered and remaining still haven't. But based on my latest check, we are only left with 20 customers to bring up the new peer. Okay, my last slide, upcoming event, Equinix Asia Pacific Forum 2016 will be actually held in Ho Chi Minh City, Vietnam, from 9th to 12th August 2016. please mark it on your calendar. And we all see you there in APF 2016. I think I'm done with my slide. Do you guys have any question for me?
Excellent. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Next up, I think Raf's back. Aren't you for round three appearing personals?
Did I upload the slides? I think we only got one, Kamzi for Akamai. You go. Okay. Oh, okay. Not Kamzi.
Kamzi is too busy to run for the EC, so I do it for him. Two live or still, we now connect to more than 100 IX, as Kamzi already mentioned in the presentation. So we pretty much update our peering DB. Feel free to peer with us anywhere. And the next one, showing up here. That's the AS number we acquired from Polaxic. So this AS, we do some anti-cast things, so we are a bit more selective on the bilateral peering. So feel free to contact us if you want us to absorb your DDoS traffic or the botnet traffic. So that's a completely different choice profile. So chat with us, and then we can bring up the session. Thank you.
All right, thank you. So this is actually the end of the third session of the peering forum. So coming next is the Equinix peering social. It's being held on the fourth floor, so downstairs. I've got five tickets left. Actually, I've got four tickets left. I need one myself. So if you don't have one yet, come over to me. Does anyone else have any tickets extra? No, we've given it all out. No, I'm saying, does anyone have extra tickets? Tina? No, Gurab? No, no more tickets? Oh, Horatio's got some over there. So. First come, first serve. You can try and get crash later. The API guys might not let you in, but. Well, anyway, you can give it a go. All right. So anyway, thank you very much.